Jules from GF Jules, and I am here to show you how to make cinnamon rolls today. I wanted to show you gluten-free cinnamon rolls before the holidays because I know lots of you have reached out to me and said you're excited but also nervous about making cinnamon rolls. They're a very iconic Christmas morning breakfast. I just made a batch of them here. Hi, Nora. Thank you for joining me. And I'm going to show you how to make them. The recipe is on my website, which is gfjules.com. Hopefully you can see it back here. And you can always hop on there and get it while we're going over everything today, or I'll also sort of, you know, go over the numbers that I'm using right now. Thank you for the hearts. I love making cinnamon rolls because it is a Christmas tradition in my house. My grandmother made cinnamon sticky buns, and so they look a little different than this. You'd flip them over upside down and they have all that sticky, gooey, yummy stuff on top. And we made those when I was growing up, and I sort of deconstructed the recipe and figured out, thank you for the hearts, figured out how to make them gluten-free, and so we make those in our house every year for Christmas too. And there is a recipe for those on my website. So if you type in cinnamon sticky buns or something like that on gfjules.com, you can get that recipe as well. And they're equally yummy, they're just different. So anyway, if you wanna make these, I'm gonna show you how to do it today. And I'll also take your last minute baking questions. So if you've got some questions about other types of recipes or any questions about gluten-free baking in general, I'm happy to help you. I switched it around today, and I'm actually going to use the mixer here and my oven over here. Normally when I'm doing Facebook Lives, I'm on the other side of the kitchen, but it made more sense to be over here. So if you're wondering if I'm in a different kitchen, no, it's the other side of my kitchen, so I'm just flipped it around. All right, so the way Facebook Lives work is that you can type in a question as I'm going, and I'll see it pop up. But sometimes a lot of people ask a question at the same time and I can only see a couple at the same time. So if I don't see your question, if I don't answer your question, hi Melissa, then please just type it again because it'll pop back up again later. And if at the end I don't see your question and don't answer it, I will go back through the comments and answer them after our Facebook Live is over. But the objective today is to show you how to make homemade gluten-free cinnamon rolls. And again, the recipe is at gfjules.com. Hi Patrick, happy holidays to you as well. And yeah, so let's get started. This is a fun recipe because this was not originally my recipe. This recipe came from a reader. So if you've got a great recipe you'd like to share using my GF Jules flour and you think I'd like to try it, please let me know because I'm always open to getting recipes from other people too. The flour that I'm using, as I mentioned, is my GF Jules flour. It makes it super easy because all you have to do is just dump that in instead of having to measure a whole bunch of different other flours out. The thing that sets my flour apart, well, there's a couple things to do, but the reason why I love using it is because everything that you bake with this flour is light and soft and fluffy, and it doesn't have any grit, and it also has some stretch to it. So you'll see in a minute when I roll out the dough, it doesn't break or crack or fall apart, which is awesome because it is no fun making a pie crust or a cinnamon roll that breaks on you. I'm sure lots of people have had that experience. You can give me a thumbs up if you had that experience. I've had too many of those experiences to count. In my early years of gluten-free baking. I've been doing this for a really long time now. I've been gluten-free since the 1990s, so yeah, I've been around for a while baking gluten-free, which is again why I invite your questions. I'm happy to help you in any way that I can to make your holidays and your baking as happy as possible. The other thing that I love about using this flour is that it keeps your baked goods fresh longer. So if you bake the cinnamon rolls today, they're still gonna be yummy tomorrow. A lot of times you'll bake something gluten-free and it tastes okay when it comes out of the oven, but the next day it doesn't taste so good. That's not the case when you use my flour. So that is the flour that I'm using today. If you wanna use a different flour, you're more than welcome to do that. Your results will not be exactly the same, but I can't tell you how they're gonna differ because I haven't tried every single different flour combination. This is the one that I figured out for myself that I use in all my baking and it always works. So that makes my life a lot easier, so I'm sticking to it. So again, gfjules.com is where the recipe is. This recipe came from a reader and I would love to see your recipe sometimes if you'd like to send them in. It's called the gluten-free cinnamon rolls, so you can look on the recipe on gfjules.com. I printed out a copy of it so that I can look along here. Thank you for the thumbs up, so that I can go along with it. What I've done, because the reader who sent the recipe in used 5.5 cups of my flour, and that's a lot of flour and it's a lot of rolls, and I will do that like on Christmas Day, but for a time like this when I'm, you know, preparing them in advance just to show you guys, or just for a Saturday morning, I have the recipe. So what I did is I put in parentheses next to every amount, I put the half amount on there, and that's what I'm going to do today. So I'm only going to be using 2¾ cups of flour and only one egg, and you know, so that kind of thing. So you'll see when you follow along, if you're like, wait, that's the wrong measurement, I'm using the half measurement. So I've got a fantastic sugar cookie recipe. It was so easy, added coconut flour. Oh good, that's fantastic. A lot of times when people use coconut flour, they initially have problems converting because coconut flour does require a lot more moisture when you're using it in a recipe. So if you're taking a wheat flour recipe and you want to sub in coconut flour, you definitely are going to probably need to add some more liquid to it. So, but anyway, thank you. I love positive stories about gluten-free baking. That's what it's all about. So anyway, so I'm gonna keep going, and hopefully, as Nora says, it just froze up. I hope it's gonna keep going, but give me a little thumbs up here if it's still going, so that I know that I can skip ahead. I don't wanna lose anybody in the transition as if the Facebook thing is skipping. But so basically, I'm gonna start out with setting up my yeast. And I wanna mention a couple things about yeast. Most yeast that you buy in the grocery store, you recognize these kinds of things. Thank you for the thumbs up, so we can keep going. Most yeast you buy in the grocery store, you recognize it in packets like this, like Fleischmann's or Red Star. Those are all gluten-free, so you don't have to worry about that. However, I'll give you one caveat. There is a Red Star brand yeast packet that is in a silver container, and it's like packets are silver colored, and it's called Platinum. That has a dough enhancer in it, and that is grown on wheat. So that Platinum yeast from Red Star is not gluten-free, and they don't say gluten-free on it, so it's not like there's anything confusing. But if you're buying any of the other Fleischmann's or Red Star products, they should totally be gluten-free. In gluten-free baking with yeast, I like to use the quick rise yeast or the rapid rise yeast. And the reason is because you'll see as I go along, I'm not going to be, you know, kneading this dough, I'm not going to be punching it down, I'm not going to be setting it aside to rise and then punching it down again. All of those steps we're going to be skipping because we're doing gluten-free. And with gluten-free, you can go much faster from start to finish baking a yeast bread. That's a bonus, right? And that's a good thing. We need to celebrate all the good things we have when we're baking gluten-free. And that's one of them. So because of that, I'm using Rapid Rise, or this is, Rapid Rise from Fleischmann's. You can always also use the Red Star Quick Rise. This is just what I happen to have. The recipe as written, as I said, is a double kind of recipe. And so it would call for 3 tablespoons. Well, in each packet like this is 2¼ teaspoons of yeast. So you'd need to use more than 2 of these packets. I have tried it a couple different times having it, and I found that actually just using 1 packet, if you're having it, works just fine. So if you're doubling it, I don't think you need to use the 3 tablespoons. I think you could just use 2 of these packets. Just throwing that out there. All right, so what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna do something called proofing the yeast, which is always good to do if you have extra time, just to make sure your yeast is good. Because if it doesn't start to bubble up and get all frothy, then you know the yeast has gotten bad, and then you have to start over again so it doesn't ruin your recipe. You don't have to do the proofing stuff. You can just add it into the dry ingredients if you want to, but I'm gonna show you how to proof it. In this recipe, we're using some warm water, and yeast is a living organism, and if you've never dealt with it, it can be intimidating, but don't let it be intimidating because it's very easy to work with when you know what you're doing. If you imagine that it's a little pet, and you want to love the pet, and you want to like take care of the pet, what does the pet need? The pet needs food, the pet needs water, and the pet needs to be warm and loved, right? So you don't want to scald the pet, you don't want to freeze the pet, so you want to, thank you, you want to make sure that you're adding warm liquids, you're adding a little bit of sugar, and you're adding the liquid as well to it, and the sugar is for food, and it's the warm temperature. So if you stick your finger in the water, the milk, whatever you're doing, and it's not too hot, but it feels warm to you, that's about right. So what I've done is I've heated up a little bit of water here. Like I said, I'm having the recipe, so I just put a half cup of warm water in here. And then I'm going to add to it a half cup of buttermilk. Now, I don't do any dairy, and so all of my recipes have substitutions for dairy. You could use buttermilk, as the recipe notes, or you could do what I did. I used a non-dairy milk, and I added a little bit of white vinegar to it, or you could add some lemon juice to it, and that turns it, and then it turns it more into a buttermilk. So it's sort of curdled here. So. See, my first baking with your product, I'm a regular baker. Let's see, quick question, can you use buttermilk bread recipe? Oh, the more questions I get reading. Can you type it out again? I'm so sorry. Can you use a buttermilk, I think is what your question was. I'll back up just really quickly and tell you that for yeast breads, most of the time you can just take like my flour and use it in any regular wheat flour recipe. When it comes to yeast breads, because the directions are so different, I always recommend that people start with a gluten-free yeast bread recipe. So if you go to my website, for example, I've got tons of yeast bread recipes on my website. So start with one of those. Get the feel for how the directions work. And then if you want to start experimenting with a regular yeast bread recipe that's wheat-based and using the gluten-free flour, then you can go from there. Because you'll see, if you're an experienced baker, like you noted that you are, you're going to say, wait, you missed a step. You forgot to do this. You didn't do that. You're doing it all wrong. Because it's gluten-free, okay? It's totally different. Can you use buttermilk in your gluten-free bread? Yes, you can use buttermilk in the gluten-free bread, okay? So I think that was the question, and yes, you absolutely can use buttermilk in the gluten-free bread. That will taste the, it will change the taste a little bit, which is a good thing, and it will taste like really yummy. So in my gluten-free bread mix, or the recipes where it's noted, you can use your sparkling liquid, or you can use milk, or you can use yogurt. You could also use buttermilk. So yeah, or make your homemade buttermilk like I just did. So a half cup of this warm buttermilk that I made, dairy-free, and I'm just gonna dump that in here with my warm water. And then I'm going to add my sugar, right? I'm gonna feed my little pet. Oh, Merry Christmas to you too. And so I've got my sugar, I've got, I'm having the recipe again, so I did a quarter cup of sugar, and then I have a little bit of melted butter, this is 2 tablespoons, and I use Earth Balance buttery sticks because they're vegan, and I think they work great. I love them in my baking, so that's what I use. So I melted 2 tablespoons, and I'm sorry you can't see this right now, I'm gonna move the camera in just a second, but all I'm doing is dumping it all into a bowl. And then I'm gonna add my yeast, so, here we go. I'm just gonna open the yeast packet. And again, if you're just joining us, I'm using a rapid rise yeast because we get to skip all kinds of steps when you're baking gluten-free. You guys are gonna be so surprised at how fast this recipe comes together. Even with me, Gavin, it's gonna come together really fast. And you're gonna wonder why you don't bake these things every Saturday. I'm telling you, they're really, really good. All right, so I'm gonna add my yeast and just stir it up a little bit. I'm gonna grab a whisk here in a second and I'll show you why. So I'm just mixed it all up in here and it's gonna get a little bit clumpy because the yeast is wanting to stick together and that's why I'm gonna get a whisk. So I'll show you that in here in just a second. Okay, we're gonna set this aside for a minute and while that's sitting aside, I'm going to mix up my yummy sugar and cinnamon and butter concoction that goes in the middle of the cinnamon rolls that makes them so scrummy. So I'm gonna mix that up now. The filling is, again, 2 tablespoons of butter, which I've melted, and I just used the Earth Balance buttery sticks. I may need to watch later. Yes, I know. I'm so sorry it's freezing up on you, Nora, but hopefully when we record it and then save it for later, it should hopefully not skip around. I hope not, yay. All right, so this is the almost 2 tablespoons of butter, and I'm going to add that in to another bowl. And I just melted my buttery sticks. And I'm gonna add a half cup of brown sugar, and you could use coconut palm sugar here if you like. I know a lot of people like to do the unrefined coconut palm sugar. It tastes really good and it works great in a recipe like this. And then I'm gonna do a half cup of regular granulated sugar. So, let's see. It's a little dark here. It's raining where I am today, so it's been kind of dark and it's hard for me to see, but I think that's a half cup. So, let's see. Half cup, yes, half cup of regular sugar, and then a half cup of, I'm just using regular brown sugar here today. And then we're gonna add some cinnamon to it as well. Let's see, oops, no, I didn't, I'm having it, so I need to do a quarter cup. That's all right, quarter cup of the brown sugar, and then a little bit of cinnamon, which is 1 tablespoon of cinnamon. Can't wait to try these. I'm so glad you're excited to try them because I'm telling you, they are so, so, so good. And these are gonna be extra good because I used too much sugar on the inside. Don't tell anyone. No one's gonna complain about that, I'm sure. All right, so I'm just gonna stir this up right here. Oh, I'm so glad you love my flour, Pam. Thank you. It has been a lifesaver for me, I'll tell you that. It just makes everything so easy. And it's nice to be able to cruise around the internet and find recipes and open old cookbooks again and find recipes and just know that it's gonna work. That's a pretty nice feeling, so I'm glad that you're enjoying it as well. So the idea behind this stuff in the middle is it's just gonna be this kind of crumbly goodness. And you can see right here, it's just a crumble of sugar and butter and cinnamon. That's all it is. Merry Christmas and happy holidays, Kathy. Thank you. I hope you guys are all ready. I want someone to come over to my house and wrap my presents. If anyone would like to volunteer, I have not wrapped a single present. But you know what? I'm baking, so it's fine. All right, so this is all mixed up here. And I'll set that over here. Now, this is something that you could make in just a bowl with a spoon. You could totally do that. I am actually gonna use my mixer just because it's sitting right here and I only have to mix it up for a second. The recipe as written, because I said it came in from another reader, I think she used her family recipe and the directions, as I mentioned earlier, were specific to a yeast bread that is using gluten. So you have to exercise the gluten. You have to do all kinds of stuff to it, which we're not gonna do any of that stuff. So I skip a lot of steps that are in the recipe and I quoted the recipe as it was written by her because she says it works for her to do it that way too. But I think you can expedite it and you don't have to mix it. I think she mixed it for like 8 or 10 minutes. I mix it just until it comes together and that's all. Because I think with gluten-free yeast breads, another thing you wanna do is you don't wanna overwork them because it can make things get tough. So if you're just joining us, this is what we're making. And you can see like how soft and yummy they are. They're not tough in any way. They're like super squishy and yummy. And I'm gonna put some frosting on them in a little while because they just come out of the oven. So I didn't wanna overwork my dough. So that's why I only do it for a second. All right, let me just get my whisk real quick and I'll show you how we whisk this together and then we'll add the dough. Okay. All right, so you can see it's getting a little bit clumpy in here. And so I'm just gonna whisk it together so that the yeast gets all mixed up and it doesn't have lumps in it. So there you can see it and it's all smooth. So we're gonna let that sit for a second and I'm gonna measure out my flour. Now, how many of you guys weigh your flour versus scooping your flour into a measuring cup? Like, I don't know, just tell me what you do, which do you prefer? Because I'll show you how to do both, just so you know how to do it. But I'll tell you, my personal preference is to weigh them. Now, not everyone has a scale. They're not expensive. Maybe it's not too late to add this to your Santa list. But I think it does help to get your dry ingredients to be exactly the right weight. Because a lot of times people will measure something and they'll say, you scoop it. Yeah, scooping and scales. Yes, Patrick, I know you use a scale. You and I are you know, on the same page with that. But a lot of times people will take their flour and let's say this is my measuring scoop and they'll scoop it in here like that and they'll say, okay, here's how much flour I have. That is not the way to scoop your flour. If you are using a scoop, then what you want to do is actually use a scoop and scoop it and put it into your flour cup like that. And then you just level off the top when you get to your cup. You weigh. Yeah, oh good. I'm glad you like to weigh it too. Because that's how you get an accurate measurement. So if someone, a recipe writer like Chef Patrick or like I'm writing a recipe and I say, you know, you want to use 1 cup, then what you want to do is put it into the cup like that. Because did you know, if you drive that measuring cup in there, like I showed you like that, if you do that, you are compacting the flour and you can throw your recipe off by as much as 25%. So if you do that, then you might actually be coming up with something that's too dry or it's crumbly or whatever, because there's too much flour in there. There's not enough liquid. So just think about it and note that, you know, if you have a recipe that didn't maybe turn out great and maybe that was the problem. So you want to make sure you put the flour into the scoop or you weigh it. If you are weighing flour, my flour, 135 grams is 1 cup. So 135. And if you need to know that, I usually put the weights into all of my recipes at gfjules.com. But at the FAQs on my page, if you go to the top, that's one of the FAQs. You can always find it there. 135 grams equals 1 cup. So in this recipe, like I said, it's 2 2¾ cups of my flour, my Jif Jules flour, but that is 371 grams. So I'm just gonna weigh that out here in my little scale. And you wanna when you have a scale, you want to tear it. So T-A-R-E, that is, so that you're not also weighing this. You want that the bowl that you're using to weigh zero. So you want your scale to think that that doesn't weigh anything. So 371 grams. Let's see, almost there. And this is, it's so much quicker too than doing 2 3/4 cup, but whatever, it's no big deal. 371. And just, I know a lot of people ask me, you know, how do you store your flour? I just keep my flour in a clear container like this that has a rubber gasket on the top to keep air and moisture out. That way I can see when I'm low on flour and I know I need to get more. Plus it also just keeps it nice and airtight in here and doesn't get moist. So I don't put it in the refrigerator, I don't put it in the freezer. My flour is low fat, low protein, so it doesn't have anything to go rancid like that, so you don't have to store it in the flour in the freezer. If you want to, that's totally fine, but going back to the weighing part a minute ago, if your flour is cold, you're getting it out of the fridge or the freezer, you need to let it come to room temperature before you start scooping it, because it's gonna actually scoop differently and it's gonna be compacted just because it's cold. So if you are somebody who likes to keep your flour in the fridge or the freezer, make sure you do bring it to room temperature before you weigh it. That's with any flour, not just mine, that's just a flour tip. So, okay. So I'm gonna set this aside and I have my 371 grams of gfJules flour. And then to that, I'm just gonna add a little bit of salt. And again, I'm doing half, so let's see, the salt, 1 teaspoon of salt. So let's see here, and this is, I just use a granulated sea salt. Okay, so now I have all my dry ingredients right here, and then the only wet ingredients I'm gonna add besides all the liquids that I added before, good to know, I'm glad that was a good tip for you, Paula, is my one egg, or if you want to do an egg substitute, a good one for yeast breads, which I really like, is to use flaxseed meal and water. So in this case, I'm only subbing for one egg. So I would do 1 tablespoon flaxseed meal plus 3 tablespoons warm water. And let that steep, like just sort of sit and it gets sort of thick and viscous, egg-like. So it gives you that kind of, you know, stretchy stuff that eggs have that are really good for holding yeast breads together. So that's what I would use here. And I do that in all of my yeast breads when I'm doing shows and I want as many people as possible to get to taste the food that I'm making. I will do a flaxseed meal and water mixture when I'm doing yeast breads in the bread maker or, you know, anything else that I'm using that for. So if you need an egg substitute. Also, if you need egg substitutes, go to gfjules.com. I have a whole article on my favorite egg substitutes and which applications they work in best. Also, another article on dairy-free substitutes. So, just so you know. All right, so I'm gonna add this to my mixing bowl real quick, just my one egg. And I will ask you to forgive me for just a second because, actually, I'll just do this real quick with my whisk, because this is a really loud mixer. So, luckily I don't have to do it for 10 minutes. I can do it for just a couple minutes and it won't be a problem. When I'm mixing things up, a lot of gluten-free flours, like mine, are really light and fluffy. And so I want to put some flour in and I want to put some liquids on top so it won't get all, like, you know, the flour won't go flying everywhere. So making these tomorrow for Christmas morning, I'm so glad, Cindy, yay. And so I'm making them now and you can see how to do them. A little refresher if you've made them before, but now you'll get to see, you know, these are the final results before they have the frosting on them, obviously. But so I'm going to put the egg down here and then I'm just going to add my flour and then I'm going to put the whole mixture that we did at the very beginning of the yeast and everything in here, I'm gonna add that next here. So, there we go. Making a little bit of a mess, but that's okay. That's what baking is all about. At least that's what I think baking's all about. Apparently that's what my kitchen thinks baking is all about, because my kitchen's always a mess. All right, put that over here, and then I'm gonna add my liquids to it. And again, this is just that homemade buttermilk that I made that's dairy-free. This is the water and the sugar and the yeast. Oh, with a little bit of melted butter. So again, the recipe's at gfjules.com if you want the exact measurements. I'm just pouring this in here. And then we're gonna mix it all up. And I'll tell you, I've made this recipe a number of times and I have been adding a little bit of extra water to it when I make it. just because I think with yeast doughs like this especially, and like challah, if anybody makes challah, I think that the dough works a little bit better when it's wetter. And I don't mean wet. What I mean is that it's looser. And so if it's a really tight dough and it doesn't seem to want to stretch, and you're using my flour and you know that my flour gives it stretch, then I'm thinking maybe you need a little bit more liquid in there just to give it a little bit more stretch. So I sometimes add a little bit of extra water as it's mixing up just to see how it goes. So we'll see. We'll see how this goes. But I think I'll get like 2 tablespoons or so of extra water. And I noted that in the recipe so that you can see it. So let me just get my water real quick. And as it's mixing, I can add that in. So let me just do this here, and I'll show you what the dough looks like. Start out slow so it doesn't, you know, go flying everywhere. And then I'll see if I need to add any more water. Good. That's 2 tablespoons of extra water, so we'll give that a go. I'm just going to mix it till it's all integrated, and then I will be done. I'm not going to add extra time. So there we go. And again, you can do that by hand. It's just going to take a little bit longer, and I didn't want y'all to have to wait for that. So I went ahead and just added it all with my mixer. But since I did proof the yeast, I know that the yeast has been dissolved and is integrated in there. If you are adding it and not proofing the yeast, you may want to mix it just a little bit longer just to make sure that it's really well integrated and all the moisture is able to get to the yeast in the dry mixture. So just a little tip there. All right, get most of my batter off here. Have you guys seen these before? These are so fun. This is called a beater blade, and it has a rubber gasket on the side of it. And I've been using these for several years. It keeps me from having to use a rubber spatula as I'm mixing. This just sort of mixes it for me. Nobody can even tell. Oh, that's awesome. I'm so glad. Yay. That's the best, right? To have no one be able to tell you your food is gluten-free, that's absolutely the best, because then you can eat it, they can eat it, everyone's happy, everyone's safe. It's the best. So congratulations. That's awesome. I'm so glad to hear that. So anyway, beater blade. I think KitchenAid makes these too, if you're interested. Another little Santa thing, I don't know. But anyway, I like it. It saves time for me in the kitchen. So, all right, let me move this, and then I can move it over a little bit so you can see me. It's like it was never there. Oh, let me show you my pants. I'm ready to go today. I'm baking. I've got gingerbread pants on. I am good to go. You have a beater blade, Nora? Good. I'm glad. Oh, rum cake tomorrow? Okay, Michelle, I made a rum cake. And I sent it to my parents 2 days ago, I guess, yeah. So they got it today, and I sent it a couple days ago. And my dad texted me today, my mom's celiac, so I wanted to send them something that they could eat. And he texted me, he goes, how come it's so soft and moist, and you made it days ago? I'm like, it's my flour. Yep, that's what happens. It keeps everything nice and soft and moist, and it's awesome. So I'm so glad. It was yay. They got the rum cake, and it worked out great. So rum cake is my mom's favorite at Christmas. Well, that and cinnamon sticky buns, but you know, who's counting? All right, we can have more than one favorite. All right, so here's my dough, and you can see when I say it's wet, but it's not like sticky, you know? And then this is what we're gonna roll out. So I'm gonna have to move the camera a little bit so you can see what I'm doing. So hang on one sec, let me just angle it for you. There, all right. Now you can see what I'm working on over here. All right, so I put more of my gfJules flour out here on this Silpat just so that it won't stick. And then I'll just put the dough out here like that. And now I'm just gonna toss it around a little bit in the flour so that it is covered, but not too covered. It's not like there's tons of it on there. This just keeps it from getting too sticky. And then I'll tell you right now, because everyone wants to know, what is this sock thing? This is just One of my favorite little tools, and you can get them at gfJules.com because people ask about them all the time, but I just put it on a regular rolling pin, and then I can roll this cheesecloth-y cover in my flour, and I don't have to keep putting flour on top. So it just has some flour in it already, and then I can just keep rolling. And you could do this on your counter. You don't have to have the silicone baking mat. I just like to do it on the mat because I have one and it keeps things nice and clean. You could also put some saran wrap out on the counter, I guess, if you wanted to do that. That would be a decent way of doing it too. So the objective here, and if you look at my website, you'll see several different pictures of these rolls because I've made them and other customers have made them and they've sent them in. And you can roll it really thin and get a lot of swirls out of it, or you could roll it a little thicker and you could get fewer swirls out of it. So it's just really however you want to do it. And there's no right or wrong, which is another reason why I love recipes like this, because no one's going to say, you didn't make those right or whatever. I mean, they're going to taste good no matter how many swirls are in them. So I'm going to do this one a little bit thinner just so you can see. You kind of just want to get it like a rectangle, but it doesn't have to be perfect. There's nothing that we're doing here that has to be perfect. And just know it's going to rise because it's got yeast in it, right? So even though it looks kind of thin now, it doesn't matter because it's going to, you know, swell up and get all kinds of nice round and puffy yumminess. I can help you if you need any help eating. Yep, come on over, Terry. You can come on over and be my taste tester. All right, so this has my melted butter and my sugar and cinnamon mixture. I'm just going to crumble it all over. This is a good time to invite someone into the kitchen to help you who maybe wants to help but isn't as experienced in the kitchen, a kid or, you know, someone else, and let them do their part and they can help you and contribute. Because there's really, I mean, you saw already, there's really nothing fancy to this recipe at all. This is not rocket science, this is not hard, which is cool because I think we all think making a really good cinnamon roll has gotta be hard, and it's not. It's all about the ingredients and the technique. And the technique is easy as long as you don't pretend like it's a wheat one, a gluten one, and you don't beat it up or punch it down or do anything like that, because then you're just gonna kill it. There won't be any rise left in it at all. All right, so we wanna get it kinda out just all over the place. And you know, honestly, again, these are your rolls. You could double this if you wanted to. You could make lots more. You can put nuts in here, candied walnuts. You could do whatever you wanted. So it is all about you at this point. You could put anything in there. You could put chocolate, I mean, whatever you wanna do. So at this point, if I wanted to get more rolls out of it, then I would roll it this way, because then I'd have a long log that I could cut more rolls out of. But if I want to get more swirls, then I would go to the short end. So I'm going to show you how to do that. This is another handy tool I have on my website. I love these things. It's called a bench scraper, and you can use it to cut, which you'll see in a second, or to lift. And you know, I'm just going to use it a little bit to help me lift, but it's just a handy little tool to have. Stocking stuffers. Okay, so here I go, and you can see this is not hard, this is not complicated, it's not breaking apart, nothing is happening here that's complicated. If it starts to stick a little bit, then you just take your bench scraper, or you could use a regular knife. These look easier than I thought. Exactly, that's the whole point, that's what I wanted to show you, because it's not hard to make it. And if you're using another flour and it's breaking apart on you like this, then you know it's not you, it's the flour, and don't give up, just use my flour next time, and then it'll be fine. All right, so we have this nice, gorgeous, long log, and I'm just gonna take a cookie sheet with parchment on it. I love using parchment. One reason I like using parchment is because it means I don't have to clean the pans, which is great. I love that. And then the other reason is because it keeps cross-contamination at a minimum, and it also keeps things from sticking and burning. And so you don't want these yummy like cinnamon rolls to have like burned bottoms on them. So I always like to use the parchment. So back here to my roll. Let me move this so you can see what I'm doing. All right, everybody see that? Okay, Now all I'm going to do, like I said, is take my bench scraper and I'm going to cut. But you could use a, could use just a butter knife if you wanted to. It's no big deal. And you kind of make them the size that you want them to be. And you want to leave some room on the pan for them to rise, of course. But you can see how pretty that is? And so the difference between this one is, you know, this one over here, I did fewer rolls. And this is gonna rise, obviously. This is already done rising. But this is gonna have more swirls. This one had fewer swirls. There's no right or wrong. And they're all beautiful, and they all are gonna taste yummy. So you wanna sort of set them a little bit apart. And what I like to do is the part that's sticking out, because sometimes it'll swell up and open, I like to keep that on the inside so that another one will push against it and it won't open up. So again, I mean, there's no, you don't have to make them a certain size. You, I mean, honestly, it's whatever you want to do. And they're going to be yummy no matter what you do. They're going to be beautiful. Everyone's going to want seconds. You're going to wish you doubled it. That's probably why the recipe was written the way it was, because they probably made it the way I do. And they're like, okay, this is ridiculous. We need to double it because everyone wants more. All right, let's see. And then when you get to the end, you kind of have like maybe one of these guys that doesn't hold together as well because it's the end. And that's okay too, because, you know, when you want to taste it and make sure that it's okay and you want to give it to your neighbors or you're going to share it with people on Christmas morning, that's yours. You get to taste that one right away. And baker's choice, right? You get to be the one to taste test it. All right, so literally, that's it. And if you wanted to double it, you just have a full tray of them. You could also put this inside a baking, like a Pyrex or something like that. Just make sure that you leave enough room for them to rise and expand. You could do it in a circular tray too. That would be fine, like a cake pan. So now all I'm gonna do is cover them with another parchment. And I have my oven on right now to 200 degrees, and I just turned it off. So it's warmed up to 200. Whoopsie, just spilled my water. It's warmed up to 200 degrees. And so I just turned it off. It's a really nice place to rise your rolls if you have them on. My water everywhere. If you have your oven on 200 and then turn it off, and then I'm just gonna stick these in there to, oh yeah, Patrick says he makes them in muffin pans, which is another really good idea. So I'm just gonna stick this in there and I turn the oven off. You don't wanna leave it on because then it'll start baking and drying them out. And I'll leave that in there for, I don't know, like 30 minutes or something like that. Just keep an eye on them, and then you'll be ready to bake them as soon as they are finished rising. So as you can see, the technique is not hard at all. It's very, very easy. And once you have the right ingredients, you have the recipe, it didn't take any time at all. And I was chatting, right? So, I mean, you know, if you kind of like don't talk to everybody while you're doing it, you can get it done much faster. Does anybody have any questions about this? This is, like I said, this is what they look like when they're done. And I'm gonna put a nice like glaze frosting on it, which is super easy. That's just butter, like melted butter or buttery sticks, sifted powdered sugar, some vanilla, and then whatever milk you like, just to get it to drizzle consistency. I'll take a picture of it a little bit later when I put it on there. And then the one that's in there now has more swirls, and so that's gonna look a little bit different. But again, there's no right or wrong. So you're welcome, Paula. Merry Christmas to you too. I hope everybody has a great Christmas. I hope you guys feel empowered to go bake. I hope you find recipes on GF Jules or other places, like the Gluten Free Cookie Swap as a great place to go find some good recipes, or share a recipe at the Gluten Free Cookie Swap. And you could win some amazing prizes there. So check that out on Facebook. And yeah, you can always reach me on Facebook, or you can reach me at gfjules.com. I am here to help you. I'm here to inspire you and to make sure that all of your baking is happy. I'm so glad you liked it, Jennifer, and you know, if I can help you in any way, please leave us a message, either a phone call or an email at gfjules.com, or you can reach me here on Facebook. And someone's asking about making them the night before. That is a great question, and I knew someone was going to ask that question, and I've had a lot of people tell me that they've done different things. And so basically, because this is a yeast recipe, like what we were discussing earlier, What you want to do, I think that works the best is, yes, and you can add the cream cheese to the glaze mixture. Yes, yes, just like cinnamon. That's awesome. I've seen several recipes for that. So yeah, feel free to use whatever glaze you want on there. You don't have to use the one that goes with this recipe, but with cream cheese in it would be amazing. But yeah, to make them the night before, what I would do is take it to this step here, and you could either go ahead and rise them, and then once they're risen, you would then cover it with, leave the parchment on top and put plastic wrap over it and put it in your refrigerator. And then the next day, let them come to room temperature and then bake them, like according to the directions. Or if you wanted, at that step that we just got to a second ago where I finished rolling them, you could cover them and put them in the refrigerator then, and then the next day, bring them to room temperature, then rise them, then bake them. I think sometimes I find that, you know, with my time the next day, if I wanted to make them the day before anyway, I probably don't have a lot of time the next day, so I would want them to be risen first. And so I would just go ahead and do this step, and then all you have to do is let them come room temperature and then bake them the next day. You don't have to add the extra rise time to it. So that's what I would do. Make sure when you put them in the refrigerator that they're covered with plastic wrap really well so that moisture, they don't get dried out. Because you put any baked goods in the fridge and they're gonna dry out whether they're baked or not. So, you know, to that point, when you've made them, don't put them in the refrigerator after that because they'll just dry out. Although I have had lots of people tell me that they freeze them and then bring one out at a time whenever they want them and heat it up in the microwave, which just sounds like awesome to me because then you don't have to make them every day. You can have a bunch of them in the freezer, which is pretty great. It's a really, I like that idea actually. I might be doing that one myself, but yeah, great question. And I love the cream cheese idea. I've seen lots of those frosting icing recipes for cinnamon rolls that have cream cheese in them. And there are dairy-free cream cheeses out there. So just because you're dairy-free doesn't mean you can't have it. There are lots of really good ones. Kite Hill has a good one. I think Follow Your Heart is the other one that I see a lot of. That's they're vegan cream cheeses. So yeah. And then yeah, you can put raisins or chocolate chips or nuts or whatever you want in the middle. Your buns, baby. Put whatever you want in there. And yeah, it's awesome. So easy. When I do a cooking class, I always say at the end when I do something, I'm like, raise your hand if you couldn't do that. And usually people are like, yeah, I think I could probably do that. That looked pretty easy. And it is easy. There was really nothing to it. It just was a matter of having the right recipe and having the right ingredients. Because, you know, sometimes, yeah, it does look easy, Nora. Sometimes, you know, if you're using the wrong ingredients and you don't have success, then you think it's your fault. It's probably not. It's probably the ingredients. I never give my dough to rise. It all comes out hard and flat. Any tips? Well, Mandy, do you proof your yeast first? Because that would be something that I would look for first. If you proof the yeast, the stuff that we did here, and there's no frothiness, there's no like yeast smell that, you know, you've smelled that in a bakery before. If you don't have any of that, then your yeast is no longer active, and so that's not your fault. You want to throw it out and go get some new yeast. Even if the packet has a date on it that hasn't passed, the yeast could have been exposed to something or could be just persnickety. So you want to start over again with new yeast. The other thing, you know, it could be if you're baking at altitude, sometimes that has some issues. I have tips for baking at altitude on my website too if you want to look for that. Other than that, I think the thing that I see the most as problems for people who are baking yeast breads and they don't rise is the technique. And that is that maybe they're a really accomplished baker and they've been baking gluten bread for a long time. And you just sort of fall into your old habits of baking gluten bread, which would be kneading it or mixing it for a really, really long time, turning it out onto a board and kneading it and then letting it set aside and to rise and then punching it down and then bringing it out again and letting it rise and all that. None of those steps you want to do with gluten-free, because when you do, those are all to exercise the gluten, and there's no gluten, obviously, in gluten-free. So all you're doing is just punching the life out of it, and it goes flat. So I hear a lot of people say that, even with cinnamon rolls. I had a class once where a guy said, I finally have my grandmother's cinnamon rolls back. I used your flour. It was amazing. They just were still kind of flat, but they tasted really good, and I asked him his process, and he followed his grandma's recipe. So he did all of those steps. And he killed it. So I'm surprised he got any rise out of it at all. But if you skip it, all of those steps, and you're gentle with it, and you baby it because it has that pet in it, that nice little yeast pet, then you want to just mix it as long as it needs to be mixed, keep it warm, give it some food, and love it, and then put it in whatever shape it's gonna be in order to rise, then you're good to go. And you should get some rise out of it. If you're still having problems, of course, you can always email me or you can reach out to me on Facebook. But the other thing you could always do is add a chemical leavener to whatever you're doing. So even if it's a yeast recipe, you can add a teaspoon or two of baking powder, and that would kick it up a notch. So give that a try too, if nothing else has worked. If you also want to explore some on my website at gfjules.com, I have a bunch of articles on baking yeast bread. I have baking bread in a bread maker. I have cookie baking help, you know, all kinds of different articles like that. So just type in cookie help or bread maker or whatever, and you'll get all kinds of recipes like that. And I mean, in articles to help you. It's always the cinnamon rolls that go flat. I'll have to try using your gluten-free flour next time. Do they sell your flour in stores? Good question. They do sell my flour in some stores. We are primarily an online company because I wanted to make sure we could reach people all over the country, whether you lived in the middle of Montana or if you lived in Hawaii or if you lived in New York City. I wanted everyone to have access to it. So we focus a lot on the home delivery aspect of it. So you can get it anytime you want to, wherever you live, and we deliver right to your door. There are stores that carry it, and that's primarily consumer driven. So if you go into a store and say, please carry Jules flour, and then they'll carry it. But usually people order it online. And you can get it from gfjules.com. You can also get it on Amazon. So a lot of people go there. If you have Prime or something like that, you can order off Amazon. But yeah, I didn't realize you weren't using my flour. If you're using another flour, a lot of times brown rice flour or other gluten-free flours are heavy. And so that can inhibit rise as well. And there's none of that in my mixture. So my mixture, when you get it, you'll see it's light and fine. It doesn't have any taste or any grit or texture to it. And so everything you use it in becomes light and fluffy. It's a lot like a cake flour, which is why people love using it in rolls like this or dinner rolls or in cakes or muffins or quick breads. But it works great in cookies and bread, roux, pastries, I mean, everything, because it's just, you know, it's light, and I think that also allows the dough to rise and to stretch. So yes, Joyce, I hope you do get to try my flour next time, because I know it can be disappointing when you make something again and again and it doesn't work. It really might not be your fault. It really, really might be the ingredients you're using. And especially if you're new to gluten-free baking, you know, we have the tendency to think it's flour. Flour is flour, and it's not. I mean, if you went to the store and bought gold medal flour or Kroger brand flour, it's the same. But not in gluten-free. All gluten-free flour blends are totally different, and they behave differently, and some of them play nicer than others. So you've made these several times, Connie, and they're awesome. Yes, they are easy to make. And yeah, the dough is so fun to work with. So thank you for, oh, Merry Christmas and sugar cookie recipe, yes. Merry Christmas to you, Connie. Thank you very much. I'm so happy to know that. That really does make my Christmas. I love hearing when people have been able to use my flour or my mixes and have success and brings their favorite holiday baking memories back again, because that's what it's all about. Like, that's what it's about for me too. So, you know, that's, I have so many amazing memories of my grandmothers at Christmas, and I just didn't want to let go of that. I wanted to be able to bring their recipes back and to share those with my family. So that's, you know, that's what it's all about. So I love hearing that. So Merry Christmas to you too. Any other baking questions? Anybody have any burning desire to make something gluten-free that you've never tried before and want to know how to do it? I'm happy to help you. So fire off a question if you have one, and if not, and you come up with one later, you know how to reach me on Facebook at GF Jules, or you can also reach me, obviously, at gfjules.com. Hi, this is Hayden. I'm watching. Yes, 10 years old. I have celiac. Excited to try your bread. Oh, and you know what? I have celiac too, so you're cool. We are in this together, and I'm here to help you, so I can't wait to hear how your bread turns out. And let me know. Send me a picture. Post it on my Facebook page. I'd love to see that. Gluten-free cheese wafers. Yeah, totally. Gluten-free cheese wafers. I have made homemade crackers and homemade wafers plenty of times, and I've published a couple of them at Gluten Free and More magazine, and they've turned out great. That's the kind of thing where You could use a regular recipe and just sub in my flour. With gluten-free cookies or bread, anything you're making tend to take longer to bake. Actually, I kind of almost find that they take less time to bake, and so I always, the first time I'm ever trying a recipe, I always stand by the oven and make sure I'm not overcooking it. Like this one, for example, this was sent in by a reader. And hi, Rob, and the reader said that she baked them at 400 for 12 minutes. That seemed a little hot for me, and so I baked them at 325 for 12 minutes, and they were perfect. So if I baked them at 400, then they probably would have been too crispy. So, but then you just put some icing on top, and nobody will ever know. So that's what, frosting never hurt anybody, right? Like, put that on top, and nobody will ever know that they were overcooked. It'll be fine. Yeah, that's totally fine. So, yes, you have everything you need. So, absolutely, I'm so excited that you'll get to make it. So, for some reason, your comment got... Well, I'm sorry about that, Terry. That's kind of weird. I'll tell you that Facebook put me in Facebook jail today, and I can't comment on anybody's group pages anymore. Nice, huh? I don't know what I did wrong. I'm just trying to help people with their baking, but whatever. I guess they have an algorithm for that, so I'm sorry. I don't know what your comment was. I'm sure it wasn't spam, and thank you for sharing. But oh yeah, Terry put in a link to Sorgles, which is an awesome store if you live anywhere near the Pittsburgh area. The Sorgles store has an amazing selection of gluten-free stuff, and they have always carried my products. They've been a big supporter of GF Jules. So thank you, Amy, and everyone at Sorgles, and thank you, Terry, for sharing that. There's also a link at gfjules.com. If you go to buy local at the very top of the page, you can see a map of the United States and see where it's carried. My husband is 45 years old, and I are Santa and Mrs. Claus. You're doing your Christmas baking, wearing red leggings with, oh, that's awesome, Jeannie, that's great. I'm glad you like, see, I'm wearing my my gingerbread, and my daughter and I are gonna make cookies in a little bit, and we're gonna go deliver them to the friends and neighbors. So I'm glad I'm not the only one doing my Christmas baking today, Jeannie. You have to post a picture of your leggings. I'd love to see them. These, I love these leggings because they just make me feel like, you know, I'm totally in the Christmas spirit. I get to go bake whatever I want to in my gingerbread stockings, so. All right, any other questions about baking? I hope everybody's doing lots of it. And if you want any other cookie inspiration, don't forget to hop over to the Gluten-Free Cookie Swap. You could win thousands of dollars of prizes. Yes, I did say thousands of dollars of prizes just by sharing a gluten-free cookie recipe at the Gluten-Free Cookie Swap. So definitely check it out. There's also daily flash giveaways there too, and that's kind of fun. Monica, I want my mom to make stiff crust, real pizza. Oh yeah, do a video on pizza? Sure. Actually, Monica, if you go on gfjules.com and type in pizza dough, there are a bunch of videos there. I'll be happy to do a Facebook Live on it sometime too. But there are a bunch of videos there at gfjules.com on the pizza crust. Now, I have not done a video on the stuffed crust before, but there is a stuffed crust recipe, and I think I have process shots, but maybe not. Maybe I need to do that in the new year. But the stuffed crust is amazing, and it is a real thick crust pizza, and then actually I take two pizza crusts, and I put one in the bottom of a springform pan, and I stuff it with all the yummy stuff that I want to put in there, then I put another one on top, and then you bake it, and it is just amazing. You cut it in like wedges and eat it, and oh, so good. Yes, and it's real pizza. I don't know if anybody's on Instagram or not, but I posted today, I made just regular, not stuffed crust pizza, but we had friends over last night who specifically requested my gluten-free pizza, and none of them are gluten-free because it's real awesome pizza. It's not like cardboardy kind of stuff or anything like that. And so we made everyone dress their own pizzas last night, whatever. We had some leftovers today, and I was eating cold pizza today for lunch. And you know it's good pizza if you're eating cold pizza. And that's what I was doing today. So I posted that on Instagram stories today because that was what I had for lunch. And it was really good. And that stuffed crust pizza is really good cold too. But a lot of times we don't have any extra because it's so good. I made a lot of pizza last night, so had plenty to share. That's a great one though. I'll add that to my list of Facebook Lives. If there's something else that you want to see a video on or you want me to help with, please let me know. Post a request anytime on Facebook and I will add it to my growing list of requests to do Facebook Lives. I do a lot of cooking demonstrations around the country, but you know, that's, you can only touch those people where they are right then. So these are very helpful because people can tune in from all over the world and see how to make something that they never made before or ask questions. And so that's really helpful too. So yeah, pizza, all about the pizza. Christmas pizza, right? How about that? Merry Christmas, Auntie Jules. Oh, Rob, thank you. Give my love to your babies. Yes, your babies, meaning your girls, both of them. She's my baby too. Much love to the West Coast. And to all of you out there, I hope you all have a very, very Merry Christmas. Happy baking. May all your baking be happy. May your holidays be merry and bright. And I am here to help if you need it. So I'll post pictures of these when they're done so you can see them on Facebook. And in the meantime, feel free to ask any questions on Facebook, and if you have successes or whatever, please share the recipes. Please share the pictures. I would love to see them. And yeah, so thanks for joining me today, and I hope you guys all have a very, very sweet Christmas morning. Bye-bye.